And now, of course, coming back to the place where we are, the Adhyatma Sadhana Kendra, the people who are living here for the next few months for the Chaturmas, we have Sadhvi Rajul Pradhaji, who's going to take the mic and share her thoughts.
My humble reverence to Mukhya Niyojika Ji, Sadhvi Shri Pramukh, Sadhvi Niyojika Ji, and Honorable Vice Chancellor of Jain Vishwa Bharati University, Samni Charitra Pragya Ji, who is over here, all the Samni Ji's, and respected delegates who have flocked here with a high enthusiasm to join, to join the energies to become a part of a creative solution which this conference is organized to bring up. I'm really thankful to the organizer of the conference who have allowed me to share some of my views with you all. I should start with a statement that we are living in a teenaged world. Why do I say this world as teenaged? I start with an anecdote. A teenage boy went to his mother and said, "I have three trousers, white, black, and yellow. And I have to attend a party. Which one you suggest me to wear?" She said, "My first choice is white, and the second is black." He went to the room and wore a trouser and just moved out of the house and to attend a party. Can you all guess which trouser he has chose to wear? Yes, of course. Good. You all have good experience. So this is yellow. The teenage is rebellious age. They try to do what is restricted, what is prohibited. Similarly, this world is passing through an age where people are doing what is restricted for them to do. That's why we have to arrange such conferences on ecology and economics and different things, because we are not restraining ourselves from what we need not have to, from not performing what we need not have to. So proceeding with this idea of teenaged world, some of the scholars, some of the philosophers, and some of the thinkers, they come up with the idea that we should find a solution to the problems, as we do with the children, that how can we reform them, how can we bring them to the path so that they can move towards sustainable development, which is a very beloved word to all of us. Since last many years being in academic field, I have attended lots of conferences on national and even international conferences on ecology and environmental problems, and I see people discussing and just bogging their heads to find any solution, and we are going on with such discussions for so many years. But what about the solutions? What about the things which come out of our minds when we are in the conference? We are discussing in the air-conditioned auditoriums, but outside this auditorium, what's happening? That's more important. Is there any effect of this auditorium on the masses that is living outside? So that is the main problem, that we know many things, we discuss many things, we have a lot to say, but when the question of action comes, we stand by. We are in the standby mood. We don't really understand what we should do, where we should go. So there we need some visionary. There we need some prudent eyes which can direct us where we should move. Acharya Tulsi was one of such visionary. He could see in which direction mankind should move. Actually, we are focusing on the development. The chief problem is that what definition we have, the belief system that we have in our mind is growth is economic development. And this belief is ingrained in our brains to that height that we cannot overcome in any action. So this belief system should be dismantled in the way that we should think in a different mode of evolution. Darwin has given us an evolution theory, and he has given us so much contentment that, okay, we are evolving. And we need not have to give any efforts in evolution because it's automatic or natural process, and we are going on evolving year by year or centenary by centenary. So all the things, what we have to do is we have to go for another kind of evolution. And that evolution is spiritual evolution. Our physiological system may grow complex. Our brains may work in complex modes. But what about the emotional states? How it works? Whether we are the same as we were in our ancient times, or we have changed, or we have grown. I think, from the point of view of emotional development or spiritual evolution, we need to do a lot, because that is not a natural process. That needs effort, that demands efforts, and in that direction we have to work. So Acharya Tulsi has given or chanted a clean path for spiritual evolution. And it's so simple, with 11 vows, which you all know. But to know, we are knowing them, we have written papers on them, we are also aware of the results or benefits of these 11 vows in the society. But to know is not enough. We need to act. A robber entered into your house, you know that. Suppose he is collecting all the material, your cash and jewelry, everything, you know that. Even he is carrying everything with him, you know that, but mere knowing won't help you. You should act, you should call police, you should stop him going. Somehow you have to act to stop and get your things safe. Similarly, even for spiritual evolution, even for the problems of the society today, we need some efforts. Merely knowing is not enough. So discussing in the auditorium is a part of knowing. What we have to do in our day-to-day life is more important. When may I ask you a question? Anyone of the delegate of this conference, is there anyone who has not used tissue papers or water bottles in this conference? I think I won't find a person, because everyone uses. But we are contributing to the problems through this. So these are the small issues. This is a small example which can make you aware of the things, even we are a part of the problem. And how can we become a solution? It's through anugrah. So let's, one more thing which I would like to discuss is, mankind has passed through three ages. One is the age of agriculture era, where man was very near to the nature. And he had all the resources with the nature, and he need not have to exert a lot for survival. That's why he didn't have problem. But as the industrial era stepped in, the second era, we moved away from the nature. We started even spoiling the nature. And that's how hundreds of problems were cropped up. And in the third era, which we are very proud of, is virtual era, which we are living in. And this era especially is a kind of, I can relate it with the philosophy. People say in philosophy we have questions and questions, but answers are like finding a black cat in the dark room. So similar is the case with, we have problems and problems, and when we seek for the solution, it's very difficult. It's like finding a black cat in the dark room. So it's good that we come together, we think, and people like Mr. Surendraji are more needed to discuss much and bring out creative solutions. But with that, we should adopt, we should live a life of solution, simple solutions which can contribute great to the world. What is bothering us is instincts. The instinct of living a luxurious life, the instinct of living with more comforts is something common to all of us. But it's really difficult that we come out of it. If I say you don't sit in the AC, you'll start perspiring. And it will be very uneasy for you to sit in the auditorium. Similar is the case with other all other comforts. So it's in our genes that we aspire to live with comforts. And with technological development, we are getting more and more comforts. Though it is contributing to the problems, but we are in comfort. So in that way, our genes are more towards the, it's directing our, us to move towards the comfort and luxurious life, ease life, life with ease. But today, science has developed with a genome theory where they can change the genomes. But I think even that changing of genome or transformation in the genome can also produce some more problems. So we should have a safe way to transform ourselves. And Anuvrat is nothing but an applied science of transformation. Acharya Tulsi was a visionary, and he has a determination. In the previous life, he was very much towards the spirituality. He didn't have much social concern. But as he grown up, had become an acharya, and then he started seeing the societal problems, he started thinking over the solution, and whoever comes to him, he used to get them promise to not to do one of the bad things that we commit in our day-to-day life. In that process, he used to tell the people, today you will not lie, or today you are not going to steal anything, or something like that. And for years it went on. And then finally he came up with the 84 solutions, and then it was synchronized into 11 vows of Anuvrat, which is before us. Mm-hmm. And another thing that inspired him to come up with Anuvrat idea is the atomic bombing on Hiroshima and Nagasaki that shook him. And he said, mankind should be out of such violent instincts. And he came up with the idea of Anuvrat. That's why the name is Anuvrat, because atomic bomb is called as Anubam, bomb. And then he gave the name Anuvrat, which is just a pill which can help to reduce the violence in the society. He was also a philosopher of modern times. He thought and thought, and then he came up with the idea that individual transformation is more important. Because if individual is not transformed, we cannot dream of societal transformation. So how to transform the individual? Every one of us have some or other problems. So some or other things which bother society. So how can we control those instincts? So he came up with the idea. An integrated process was designed by him, which is called as Preksha Meditation, and then Science of Living. And finally, Acharya Sri Mahapragyaji, he designed a new technique, which is called as Training in Nonviolence. Training in nonviolence is the most important thing which can help us to come out of the instincts of violence, of greed, of selfishness, and whatever negative feelings we have, they have a capsule courses to just get rid of such kind of instincts. So that's the best part, I think, of Anuvrat, which can help the society to come out of the problem. Like if you, aggressiveness, it's a common problem. Every one of us sometime in the life get aggressive and go out of temper. So how can we control? When we are in aggressive mode, we cannot stop ourselves. But beforehand, if you train the brain, okay, thank you. So I'm finishing. If you train the brain, that will help us. So concentrating on your forehead, seeing the white light over there, perception of white light over there, and then feeling that my anger is pacifying, and feeling that your anger is, your aggressive instinct is pacifying, gradually, after 3 or 6 months, you will be out of that aggressive instinct. So that's how we try to teach people. And there are hundreds of monks and nuns who are trying to teach society these kinds of Prayaksha meditative capsule courses, and they are helping people to come out of emotional problems. And there's also lakhs of lay followers, Jain lay followers, Therapanth lay followers, who are working in the field of society to de-addict the people. There are hundreds of many organizations, and lakhs of people are working tirelessly to make this society a healthy society and make this development a sustainable development. So that's how the whole organization is working in all over the India and even abroad. In many of the countries, we have centers which is working there, in America, in London, and different places where people are teached through this. Even in a Florida International University, we are teaching Jainism and other courses. So even I was, a year back when I was not a nun, I was a Samni, I was teaching at Florida International University. One day I was taking my bag, and there were ants on the road. So I just lifted up my bag and then went forward and then kept again the bag down. Then students asked me, what happened? If it is very heavy, let us take the bag. Then I said, no, I didn't take because it is heavy, because there were ants and they will be killed. So I lifted up the bag. So people were so much, those students said, okay, even these ants have life, but they don't have rationality. I said, they have everything. They have feelings, they have pain. So that's how these values were made, and this made them to feel that Jains are so much into the non-violence. And there are so many other things which I could experience with the American students. So that's how those students were so much receptive and understand, and they said, God has blessed us with sending you gods in our university. So I felt very proud of those statements said by Rabbi people. So I thank you all for giving me the opportunity to speak something before you all. And I conclude a few lines with a tribute to my guru, Acharya Tulsi. His life is a light lamp to light the lamps. His life is a living message. His life is an edifice for a better future. His life was to enlighten masses. Let us live him. Let us revere him. As he said, seek not my physical autograph, but let the message shine in your life as eternal signature. Thank you.
Om Arham. Thank you, Sadhvi Rajra Prajaji. That was very interesting to note the training in non-violence, which is something one takes for granted. Everyone knows in anger management, count to 10 and you'll be able to manage better. But the truth is, anger comes not just with the kind of food you eat, not just the kind of life you live. It's one of the emotions that exists there. And a training which just tells you that the expectation is not to have it would probably change your attitude towards it. We are forever expecting, like they said, the expectation or the instinct to have a better life, the expectation to have emotions that range so wide, allow us the liberty to express ourselves exactly how we at that moment feel. But even that feeling is guided by a behavior which we have seen and patterned ourselves on.